So, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I would like to start us off with a story about innovation and what change really stands for and really looks like. One of my favorite quotes was written by Sun Tzu in 72 BC. He was the consultant to the warlord of China, so to speak, and he wrote a book that's still famous today. He wrote the book called The Art of War. And if you ever read that book before, Sun Tzu, he released a quote in 72 BC that still holds a tremendous punch today. In that book he says, strategies without tactics is a slow road to victory, but tactics without strategies is the noise before defeat. And I believe that is considerable, comparable into today's world. If we are doing whatever we do and we have no tactics and strategies in place as to why we are doing this, we will fail. Now let me give you a story on what change really looks like and why are we changing things. Just the fact of changing things doesn't do anything. We have to have concept of change, and we got to allow ourselves to think differently as to what change actually delivers. Vince Lombardi, I'm not sure if you heard of him, he was the greatest football coach in the United States of all times, and he released a quote by saying, some of us do our job well and some don't, but it doesn't really matter, because at the end of the day we are measured by one thing and one thing only, and that is called results. So let me share a story with you that happened a few years ago and was released by the medical team of UCLA, which is one of the largest colleges in the United States. Back then, they found out that in Mongolia, at one point, if all countries in the world, most preemie babies die in the country of Mongolia. And you know what a preemie baby is, right? When a mom is giving birth to a child too early, 78% of all preemie-born babies in Mongolia died. 78%. That was a shocking number. And UCLA, being a medical research team, they flew some experts and some doctors to Mongolia to see if they can help them. Again, results was to lower the death rate of these preemie-born babies. That was their result. So they went into the hospital of the capital of Mongolia. And the first thing what they found out is that the three incubators they had, two were broken and one only worked half. So naturally so, what these research people thought, let's buy this hospital three new incubators and the reduction of these deaf babies will change. Now you know what an incubator is, right? An incubator basically reproduces the warmth and the humidity of a woman. And with that, these babies will hopefully survive. Now, an incubator in today's world is $1.2 million, one incubator. So they signed off on three new incubators for that hospital, $3.6 million investment to the hospital of Mongolia to save these babies. So everybody was celebrating because everybody felt good about their change. You know, managing change by results, ladies and gentlemen. Before that management team could leave the hospital to fly back to California, one of the nurses came up to them and said, thank you so much for buying us these incubators, but ladies and gentlemen, that will not help us. The numbers of these babies will not reduce just because you buy us new incubators. And that confused these doctors, and they said, why? And they said, because the babies already arrived dead. We have to learn the concept of change. What change really does, just because we are slapping change onto a wall, that doesn't mean anything. We have to have resource. We need to ask curious questions as to why the problem exists before we can find solutions to make that problem go away. So they start researching, finding out that Mongolia is not like Vietnam, it's not like Germany, it's not like the US where we have roads and sophistication and ambulances. And Mongolia is a country of farmers. They're living in small villages all across Mongolia. So if a mom gives birth to a preemie baby, they snap that baby on a donkey, on a horse, and it takes them 10 hours to get to the hospital. By that time, the baby is dead. So what they needed is not only incubators, they needed to find a way to transport these babies quickly from these villages on hills to the hospital. Now, what would you do in this case? Imagine you are a doctor or a research expert for UCLA. Buying them helicopters, way too expensive. Ambulances, how? There are no streets. Can't do. So when the research team came back to California, they were sitting in their think tank, in their room to make a difference. And they were brainstorming how they can save these babies when one of these guys was eating a Hot Pocket. Do you know what a Hot Pocket is? You put a sleeve on, you throw it in the microwave, and it's yummy good. You know what I mean, right? So one was eating the Hot Pocket when the other guy saw that and snapped it away from his face. I said, hey, give me back my Hot Pocket. And he took that sleeve off that sandwich and he raised it up and he said, ladies and gentlemen, here is our solution. So here's what UCLA created. They created little sleeves. They are easy to make, they're inexpensive, and they are portable. And they were given to these villages in Mongolia. And when a woman gave birth to a preemie baby, they opened that sleeve, they broke a seal that created a warming shield in that Hot Pocket that simulates the womb of a woman. And that just bought that baby 10 additional hours to get them from the village to the hospital. And by that, they lowered the death rate of preemie babies in Mongolia by over 90%. That's how winning is done. You know, when I travel the US, I travel the world, I'm an inspirational speaker. I normally speak on human capital development. And there are two forms of leadership. There's the human capital development leadership, and there is the visionary leadership. And they all have to feed each other. And when I speak of people, when I speak of service, that service is not a job, but it's a lifestyle. It's the willpower to make a difference. It's activating people's willpower to make a difference in people's lives, and not just to show up to do a job. That's one form of leadership. To inspire the world to do something new through engagement, what Greg Patterson talked about earlier. I couldn't agree more. In fact, I'm going to tour with this guy next year. Him and I, we're going to be both on stage and we're touring the world. I can't wait. I look forward to that because I look up to that man. He changes lives. That's one way of leadership. The other form of leadership is how we change things, how we become visionaries, to change the dynamics of what we really need. You know, here's my question to you. Earlier, I listened to all these incredible speakers. I mean, top notch. And I agree with all of them. Steve, I actually know his club. I used to live in Atlanta. He's a beautiful club, one of the best clubs in the United States. When I look at this, and then I saw some of your faces when these people identified the need of change, none of you disagreed. We all know that golf is in trouble. We all know that. Less and less people play golf, unfortunately. So we have to do something about that to bring people back. But yet I looked at your faces, and I could almost hear your thoughts when you said, well, yeah, that doesn't work for me. My board of directors will never allow me to do this. This is a great idea, but this is not for me. Where you distance yourself, where we recognize that maybe what these speakers spoke about, that idea doesn't work for you. But the most dangerous things we can do as leaders in this world is recognizing our limitations by not even trying to try something new. And that's what I'm seeing around the country. I travel 256 days a year. I just came back from a 10-week speaking tour in the United States. And I speak not only in the country club industry. I speak in healthcare. I speak for finance giants like Deloitte and Touche. I work with Mercedes-Benz. I work with Rolls-Royce. I work with some of the most pristine companies. And I'm trying to teach managers to let go. And ladies and gentlemen, letting go is not the same thing as giving up. Letting go is finding fresh ways to define something that works for us. Maybe something that doesn't work for somebody else, but you can make that on your own. So I want to share that challenge with you today. What I have learned, ladies, and I don't say this lightly, but what I have learned is scaring me. Because some of our managers, especially the younger ones, we have become so good in explaining why we can't do something that we forgot to find solutions and how to change things. I talk about status quo. I talk about breaking that status quo to redesign and make a difference and build a legacy for yourself. If you always do the things that you know you do well, you will never do much. And Albert Einstein says it best, who says, people who make the same mistake over and over and over again and expect different outcomes, that is the definition for insanity. So what is expected of us as leaders? What is this new generation that's now coming in? Speaking of, we're doing a lot of generational research. If you have a hard time with your current employees now, who are called millennials, wait till the strawberries come your way. And that's a global unity. Strawberries who are right now 7, 8 years old, let me tell you who they are and what they think. Working 8 hours a day? Hell no. That's slavery. Ha ha ha. 6, maybe. And you better pay me good and give me double benefits. and you do not tell me what I'm doing wrong, because my parents have never shared with me what I'm doing wrong, so who the hell are you to tell me my shortcomings? And you better give me a pat on my shoulder every 5 seconds, because I am awesome! So we have to find ways to activate the willpower of these people. And I think the only way for us to do that is through innovation, is through change management. Change management that's not forcing change because the sake of change, but making sense of what we want to change. And that needs to be defined by courage, ladies and gentlemen. Courage is measured in trying. Trying something new by not waking up, walking into your club. And so many young managers, they tell me, Andy, this has been like this for years. Why should we change that? That, to me, is the kiss of death. There's a definition of change that's called a mantra of change. What is your mantra? Mantra, change of fear? Change by fear, change by doubt, change by telling, change by force, change by bribe, or change by fun? Let me give you an example, what I've done, just one of the little things, because I think we're driving off. The future is not owned by the richest. It's owned by the people who are most flexible, who are becoming a bamboo in life, who sway, who swing, who are willing to wake up and to take chances. You know, to me, confidence is not built by you doing things that you know you make you're doing well. Confidence, to me, is built by you doing things you know you might fail, but you try it anyway. So when I was the beverage director at the Hyatt Regency Aruba, we had a pool deck that was epic. And I was the beverage director. We printed money, as Greg said. We printed money on that pool deck. And back then, I made $32,000 as the beverage director living on the island of Aruba. And I got to tell you, you know, that's not much money. So my director called me in the office and said, Andy, I want you to increase the revenue take on the pool by 3%. And I looked at him and said, Eddie, we already carrying drinks out by the busload. I had 11 cocktail waitresses running all day long. These girls made $200,000 a year. And me as the director, I made $32,000. You see, there's something wrong with that picture, right? He said, Andy, I'm giving you a $25,000 cash check if you increase the pool revenue by 3%. 6 months later, I walked in his office, and he wrote me a bonus check for $25,000 because I not only increased it by 3%, I increased the pool revenue by 6 additional percent. How did I do that? Innovation. Often, if I would be a board of directors that give me more money, how do we apply that? Because our natural course of thinking is designed that we either increase cost, increase price. That's not often wise. If you want to take more money, we charge more to our members and clients. Not very smart. Or we decrease cost. That means we are scraping our sense of quality. Also not very smart. I go back to a story that my grandfather once told me about business innovation. I must have been 12 years old when he told me that story. And I still remember that. Because learning is constant, ladies and gentlemen. When my grandfather told me about a story in the 1980s, when the marketing director for Colgate toothpaste was challenged to increase the revenue of toothpaste around the world. And he increased it not by increasing price or decreasing cost. What he did, he increased the size of the hole in the toothpaste. So basically, you use more. And that's what I did in Aruba. I called my straw companies and I said, I want you to build me a garden hose. And I want you to make that colorful and fun. So I put that in, and people drink twice as fast. And with that, I increased the pool revenue by 6%. I had more drunk people in the pool. But it doesn't matter. It's the innovation of what change really is. So I want to challenge you today to think differently. And that's called design thinking. Design thinking is not by you going out there and trying to do something new just because, but knowing the process of change. Just because you change something, that doesn't make you successful. You got to know how. How many of us have ever tried something new and it didn't work out? And what did we say? Out the window. Back. We tried. How many times I have heard that? I did my best. No, you did not. Because we are giving up in the process of measuring if success is successful or not. So I want to show you today that success is a progress, an innatory process of recognizing. And so many people have I met, their ego stands in their way by not letting go of traditional ways of being. And you know what an ego is, right? An ego is the anesthesia of that numbs the pain of stupidity. That's what an ego is. So letting go and finding fresh ways, but understanding how we change, how we become better, how do we turn something that other people say it's impossible, we turn that into a possibility. There are ways and strategic structures and tactics that we can apply. But before I do that, I want to showcase some studies that I found. And Wayne, can you give me the first slide, please? I'm going to show you some slides now of very intelligent people around the world. And these people were icons in their industry, icons. And yet, Henry Ford was right. Henry Ford once said, whether you believe you can or cannot do something, you will be right. The way you think is the way you feel. The way you feel is the way you act. And who of us here waking up and said, I'm going to make mistakes today? We have to learn to make mistakes again. We are so afraid to screw up because we are afraid of judgment. We are afraid of standing out that we are dumb and idiotic. Let me tell you something. I have a little girl at home. You know, my wife is, and speaking of change, you know, speaking of being different, I'm German-Swiss. My wife is from Spain, from Barcelona, and my little girl is from China. Her name is Emanuela, and I call her Sushi. She is my cute and angel of all. So when we walk through the streets of Singapore, are you kidding me? People look at my wife, they look at me, they look at my daughter, then they look at me again, like what happened, right? And when people stare too much, I usually say, look, if you blend Spanish and German, you get Chinese. What can I tell you? But we have to embrace change. And here is a statement right here. With over 50 foreign cars already on sale here, the Japanese auto market isn't likely to carve out a big slice of the U.S. market. Ladies and gentlemen, do you know that the Japanese auto market in the U.S. owns over 70%? This was said by smart people. They were so sure that they were right. And yet we're looking back and said, what the hell were they thinking? It is our forward-thinking ability that drives us. You know, the legacy that you leave behind. Let's face it, ladies and gentlemen. You know that you have 70 summers on this planet. That's all you have, right? 70 summers. So when you're gone, what are you leaving behind? The legacy, what people talk about you, is not being boring and redundant. The legacy of you, what you leave behind, is that you had the courage to stand up, that you had the courage to make a difference, that you stood out and you said no to status quo. When anybody else said no, you said, why not? Let's give this a shot. And yet we're afraid of losing our job. But you know, my grandfather said once something to me. And my grandfather's right here. And I kid you not, I carry him with me wherever I go. Here he is, his picture. My grandfather was my hero. You know what he said? He said, Andy, I'd rather be called crazy than living a legacy of invisibility. And if we don't change things, the industry will not change. And with that, we will die. Did you know that between 1945 and 1969, 10,000 watchmakers made their living by handmade watches in Switzerland. Did you know that? 10,000 watchmakers, their families and their families and their families and their families. Between 1969 and 1979, only 75 survived. Did you know that? Why? Because in 1969, for the very first time, the quartz, the automatic watch, was introduced. And over 9,500 watchmakers said, the hell with that, it's not going to work anyway, because we are holding on what used to be good. And eventually, they all died. And they call me crazy, people, but if we don't change that industry, we're going to be next on that statistic. We have something to protect that's bigger than us. And that's not just done by you waking up and coming to your job every day and doing the same thing over and over and again. It's to find out ways of reconnecting what really matters, and I call that courage. And courage is the only way that saves you. Because at last, ladies and gentlemen, you don't work for your club. You work for yourself and for your family. So your innovation will protect your families. So we got to be careful what we say and how sure we are. Because if we always wait for somebody else to do it first, that means we will come in second. And I tell you what, second best people will not be able to pay their bills. Check this out. Next slide. I think there's a world market for maybe 5 computers. This was set by the chairman of IBM in 1943. Do you know why? Because he said the houses are not big enough. Because the first computer was so big that he said people will not own a personal computer. This was the chairman of IBM. By the way, do you know that IBM was the first computer in the world? You know that, right? The chairman. And yet he released a statement that today is so wacky. Please do not fall into this strategy. Do not fall into this dynamics that you become one day a legacy of laughter. They said, how could we possibly have thought that way? Next. Does this work, Wayne? This telephone has too many shortcomings to be seriously considered as means of communication. The device is internally of no value to us. Ladies and gentlemen, today, look at your table, what you have, by the way. The telephone might be great, but to me, we are a generation of idiots, smartphones and dumb people, right? So, but it's still helpful. But look at this, 1876, Western Union released a statement, we do not invest in this thing called telephone. How can we have been so blind? What I'm trying to tell you, don't be so blind today. Stand up and fight a future that you create. You have the future in your hands, ladies and gentlemen, but you can't do this by accepting that status quo and saying, what can I not do? We are so busy in defining change by what we can't do, and really, we are afraid of change because we don't know the outcome. Wait till you see that exercise I'm playing with you in a second. That is revolutionary. Next slide, Wayne. The Americans have needs of telephones, but we do not. We have plenty of messenger boys. Are you kidding me? That is thinking in the past. And I walk into many, many country clubs, and it feels like I'm traveling 30 years back because nothing has changed. We need to be champions of change, not just the innovators, but we have to execute that. We have to find fresh ways to change. Now, here's a quick story for you. There's this lady in the kitchen, and she prepares a whole roast beef. You know what a roast beef is? A big chunk of meat, right? Whole roast beef. And the husband stands in the doorway and watches her make that roast beef. Salt and pepper and mustard and marinates it and rubs it. Before she puts it in the pot to stick it in the oven, she takes a knife and cuts both ends off. The husband said, whoa, honey, what are you doing there? And she said, I'm making roast beef. And he said, but why did you cut the ends off? And she said, well, that's how you make roast beef. He said, no, but why? She said, my mom taught me how to make roast beef. And she specifically said, cut the ends off. But the husband said, why? She kicked him out of the kitchen. So he started researching, finding out the grandmother one day made roast beef. The roast beef was too large for the pot. She had to cut the ends off. Today, it's a family recipe. We are celebrating inconveniences as part of our traditions, ladies and gentlemen. And that needs to change. We are moving forward. And if we don't move with it, the world will move without us. And I don't care how many excuses you have. Speaking of Topgolf, Zach, I had dinner with a good friend of mine that is very well known around the United States. His name is Michael McCarthy. Greg, you know him. He is the CEO of Edison Reserve, one of the greatest pioneers of change I've ever met. And I'm sitting with him, not knowing that I'm going to meet Zach. And 2 months ago, he talked to me and said, Andy, I'm thinking of bringing Topgolf to Edison Reserve. And I'm going to connect them if they haven't done so. This guy is a pioneer forward thinker. And I'll tell you what else what he did. He said to me, Andy, you know what I'm going to do? Is I'm going to give all my golf lessons for free. My members don't have to pay for golf lessons anymore. In fact, they can bring friends to take golf lessons with them, and I pay for it. I looked at him, what? You're losing a tremendous revenue stream. He said, no, I don't. I gain revenue because people are going to eat. In fact, I'm offering my buffet in the restaurant, which is world class, for $5. I want my people to be here. What does it do you good that I have a big business, but nobody is there? He said, I every year end up with $2.9 million in surplus. I'm a nonprofit organization. What do I do every year? I'm buying a new stupid chandelier for my entrance. Every year I'm buying a new one. And I haven't gained one member because of my chandelier. It's time for us to change. He said, the board calls me crazy, but you know what the board says? If you think that's the future, go with it. Revolutionize thinking, taking chances, ladies and gentlemen. Next picture. We don't like their sound, and guitar music is on its way out. Are you kidding me? They rejected the Beatles, a billion-dollar enterprise. I hope that guy was fired. And yet we are so sure that we have the right answers, but is it? That's called design thinking, ladies and gentlemen. Next slide. There is not much we can do to change the hospitality industry. The competitive market and the financial restraints doesn't allow much creative landscape. General Managers Meeting, current times. This is what's said in an international General Managers Meeting, word per word. And don't you tell me, isn't that how we think sometimes? Isn't that how we often fall back to excuse our limitations, to excuse our inabilities, to excuse to taking chances to move forward? Ladies and gentlemen, we gotta break that status quo. I don't care how tough your board is. I don't care. You are in charge to keep your employees safe. We have to come up. Speaking of Michael McCarthy, what he done? He has reached out to all kinds of benefit structures. I'll give you an example. He has signed a contract with a horse riding ranch. When you are a member in Addison Reserve, your children take free horseback riding lessons at that ranch. And he has done deals with restaurants. Look, this is not a reciprocation. It's not that all of a sudden you have all kinds of horse people playing golf. He's paying for these benefits out of his dues to offer an alternative for these members, restaurants, cinemas, theaters. Do you have a tremendous benefit package, including horseback riding lessons for your children for free? Carmel Country Club, South Carolina, one of the greatest clubs, used to be a core golf club by itself. When you drive up to this club, you think you're going into Walt Disney. They completely regenerated revenue by bringing families back, and with that, that club has a chance to survive. While all the other clubs around are still focusing on golf, and ladies and gentlemen, the next 10 years, these clubs are going to be gone. Simple as that. Next slide. But what is it good for? About a microchip. This was in 1968, said by somebody from IBM. He said, what does this microchip do? Are you kidding me? Today, without microchips, we would be still going back into the Stone Ages. Come on. We have to let go. These are intelligent people. Who the hell wants to hear about actors talk? This was Warner Brothers in 1927. These statements were given by brilliant people, and yet they were so wrong because they forgot something. They forgot that the future has its own funny way to write itself. And we have to either write it with it or not. Next. Radio has no future. Heavier than air flying machines are impossible. X-rays will prove to be a hoax. 1899. I can go on and on and on. Next. There will be never a bigger plane built. A Boeing engineer after the first flight of the 247 with twin engine. People are intelligent, but yet are so driven that they are right that they don't even know how wrong they are. And the funniest of all comes next, the most critical. In 1899, the commissioner of the patents office, Charles Duell, sent a memo to the White House to suggest to close the patents office because he was convinced that everything that could have been invented already was invented. Are you kidding me? So before we're going to play this game, Greg, get ready. You're going to help me in a second. I want to make a point here today, and I'm not pleading to your intelligence. I know you're very highly intelligent and functional human beings. I'm pleading to your courage to go out there and find your own ideas. And not sitting here listening to these speakers inspire you is great, but maybe that doesn't work for you. But it's not supposed to. It's supposed to inspire you to find your own creativity so you can write your legacy. So what people remember about you after your 70 summers that you've been told you've made a difference in this world. Maybe in the life of a child, maybe you revolutionized the way you're doing business. And I'll tell you something else. Watch Top Golf. What I have seen, what Zach presented today, for me, that is the future of our industry. Because it's called change by fun. Recognizing your mantra, change by fun. So, within that, I would like to play a game with you that was that's introduced all over the world now. And Peter Spillman introduced this challenge, what I'm about to do with you, at the TED Talk a few years ago. And the game is called the Spaghetti Marshmallow Challenge. And although that it sounds very easy, it is actually very hard. And here's the rules. I want you now in a second to pair up in groups of four, and Greg Patterson is gonna help me with that. So you gotta sit in groups of four, right? And you can either stand up, you can work on the table, you can go to the back high boys, so teams of four. Now, when I introduce the game, one of you of the teams of four is going back to where Greg Patterson is, and you have to get your equipment. Each team will get 20 sticks of spaghetti. They will get 4 pieces of string, 1 yard of tape, and 1 marshmallow. And here is your instruction. When you come back, when everybody is back, so first of all, we have to pair you up in groups of 4. And by the way, this is a great team-building game for your people at home with your employees. This reveals a lot about collaboration and bringing people together. But after this game is done, I'm going to reveal the message. And there's really a powerful message behind what this game is really teaching us. It's not just to build a marshmallow tower. It's how we're going to connect with that. So here are the rules. Each team gets 18 minutes to build the highest freestanding spaghetti tower. And here are the rules. You can only use the ingredients that's been given to you. 20 sticks of spaghetti, 4 pieces of string, 1 yard of tape, and 1 marshmallow. So I suggest you get together, you collaborate on what you would like to do, and I have 18 minutes. We have a timer for you, And when I say begin, you start building your spaghetti tower. However, when you are done, your spaghetti tower has to hold the marshmallow on top. So your spaghetti tower has to have the balance and the strength to carry that marshmallow on top. As I said, that sounds very easy. And the very first time I've seen this exercise, I said, whoa, this is epic. The message behind that is so incredible. So I started to do this around the world. And I told you, I speak all over the world. I spoke in Argentina just recently. I was in the Caribbean, in Canada. I'm all over the world. And I have done this exercise with CTOs of Fortune 500 companies, general managers. I've done this with nurses and doctors and physicians. I've done this with car repairmen. I've done this with school teachers. I have done this with employees, with busboys, with servers. And it's absolutely amazing what kind of creative structure people come up with. Now, 35 inches was the highest I ever seen. Now, first step, would you please pair yourself up in groups of four right now? Please, very quick. We are running out of time. Pair yourself up in groups of four. Very quick. Come on. Groups of four. All right. One of you four, would you please stand up? One of you four, would you please stand up? One, meet Greg back there and Alice, and please get your equipment very quick. We are running out of time. Come on, guys, very quick.
4, 1, 1, 20, okay? 20.
Wayne, can you get the timer ready? Yeah. Not yet, not yet.
Four
not yet.
Of these, one of these, and one that.
Very Have quick, get your fun. Equipment.
Get creative.
One marshmallow. Right.
One marshmallow. Just so everybody knows, we're getting out one marshmallow, four pieces of string, 20 sticks of spaghetti, and one blue piece of tape, from which you're going to create the highest possible...
Please, don't eat the marshmallow. We don't have
marshmallow
enough.
Marshmallow tower. 20 of those.
You know, if you want to join somebody else, it's cool. Yeah. Well, you're going to be five. That's okay, too. Are you guys a four?
Four.
Four? All right.
Four pieces of string.
We're going to pair you up. We're going to find somebody.
Right. One of those.
Who doesn't have four? Please raise your hand. Who doesn't have four?
Right on. The first one.
Okay, perfect. That's perfect. They only have three. Awesome. Thank you. Beautiful. Good. Excellent. And by the way, the marshmallow has to be intact. It cannot be ripped off. So the marshmallow has to be intact.
One marshmallow.
All right.
Just one.
And Wayne, get ready to hit the timer. And 18 minutes start now. Let's go, Wayne. Come on. Get your equipment. Hurry back to your team. Let's begin. Wayne, music. All right.
4 strings, 4 strings, 1 marshmallow, 20 pieces of spaghetti, and 1 piece of tape.
All right, please begin. Build your marshmallow towers.
4 pieces of string. The highest marshmallow tower wins $10,000.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, if you need a couple of more spaghetti, go ahead, it's okay. I'm not the spaghetti police.
Okay, if you break a spaghetti, it's too bad, dudes. You get no replacement. You have 20 pieces of spaghetti.
You might want to push these things off the, in the middle of the table so you have actually room to play. 20 spaghetti. If you need a little bit more, go ahead. Fine. I'm not counting. All right. Good. The highest spaghetti tower, huh? And since you were the best golfer yesterday, I have some high expectations of you. The highest, so you have to work together as a team to build the highest spaghetti tower. Come on. Danny, you ready?
Serious one.
16 minutes. Okay, you have to build the highest spaghetti tower. Okay, guys, hold it. You have to build the highest spaghetti, freestanding spaghetti tower out of these ingredients. The string, the tape, and 20 sticks of spaghetti that holds the...
Andy, how much time are you going to give them? We're running up against the wall here.
What?
How much time do they
have? Well, 16 minutes. So let me wrap this up.
16 minutes, okay.
So the timer, and then we're going to go quick. 2 minutes close after that. So after, right.
Let the creativity flow. Don't be constrained by the constipated people you're sitting with.
All right, guys, collaborate. Come on, build your spaghetti towers. The highest free... No cheating, man, no cheating. No looking.
That's it, Jenny.
Okay, the highest freestanding spaghetti tower.
As a group. Bad.
High expectations.
Where is the creativity, Adam?
All right. All right, guys, collaborate as a team. That's right. Well, you've got a team player on the team here. Come on.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, you have 11 minutes. That's all you've got, 11 minutes. $10,000 to the highest one.
You can do anything with it. You can cut it, you can twirl it, you can do whatever you like with it. You cannot cut the marshmallow. I know. No, good idea, good idea. You cannot, the marshmallow has to be in whole. The marshmallow has to be on top. Yeah. Good. All right, collaborate, guys. Orient yourself, all right? Come on, all right. You have still about 12 minutes. That's all you have left. 12 minutes, guys, 12 minutes. Build the highest tower. Leadership through communication, collaboration, and design thinking.
Awesome. 9 minutes and 40 good. Seconds. 9 minutes and 40 seconds to go.
It's freestanding. I'm not complaining here. That's good. That's pretty smart.
$10,000.
Oh, wow. Look at these guys back there. Oh, yeah. Okay. It doesn't matter. So far, you're the highest by a landslide. So. You can make that stand, you will win. Can you girls keep up? You're good? Okay. All right. You have about 10 more minutes to go, ladies and gentlemen. 10 more minutes to build the highest tower. All Greg, how are we doing? Good? Who's your favorite team?
Ladies and gentlemen, I have that $10,000 bid.
50. That's 50,000.
50,000.
Yeah, be up at the 50,000.
50,000 US dollars. Oh, this one looks good right here.
Yeah, this looks good.
Fire.
Yeah. This looks good.
They're doing all the work. You're just observing. You're the manager, right? I like that. Oh, that's very good.
You still have plenty of time. You still have about 7 minutes. That's 7 minutes left to build the highest structure. Innovative, I like it. Innovative, good. Innovative. Yeah, one piece, yeah. Good question. Marshmallow has to be in one piece on top. Your group of four. All right, perfect. All right, guys, time is ticking. Seven more minutes. Stabilize your design. Highest power wins. 50,000. Greg has the money. What? All right, you're established. Okay, good. Perfect. Whoa. All right. Get yourself more tape, more spaghetti, more string. It's all good.
Andy, are they going to 16 minutes? Andy, how long are you going to give them, Andy? How long? Till 16? Or what are you looking at?
No, 18. 18. We can slow down by 16.
16.
Just stop at 16.
Ladies and gentlemen, you got 3.5 minutes to go. And
all right,
the marshmallow
so you
must
wanna...
be resting atop the structure. Atop the structure.
Yes. No, 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 John, you're not. John has asked if he can eat it. John, we just had lunch. I can't give, no.
that's creativity.
That doesn't count, Joe. That doesn't count. You gotta have the marshmallow on top. Good question, Joe. You can eat it at last. John is working for beer. Hey, listen, if you get the highest tower, I buy all beers tonight. Well, there's a challenge. That's an incentive, right? Change by bribe. All right. You have 2.5 more minutes, ladies and gentlemen. 2.5 more minutes. You want to think putting the marshmallow on top, and then as we reach 16 minutes, we step away from our structure. All right, 2 more minutes, ladies and gentlemen. 2 more minutes. You want to know, the marshmallow has to be on top, guys, and it has to be the entire marshmallow. I'm giving you new marshmallow. The marshmallow, the whole marshmallow, the whole one, I gotta give you a new one. Yeah, you have 2 minutes and 20 seconds left.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a couple of towers right now. We got a couple of towers that are like 2.5 feet high. They do not yet have marshmallows on them. We'll see if they will support the marshmallow.
We already have one statue right here, and it's standing. Very good. Oh, shit. All right, guys, gentlemen, ladies, here's your marshmallow. It has to be on top. It has to be on top. Marshmallow has to be on top. Marshmallow has to be on top.
1 minute and 30 seconds, ladies and gentlemen.
Wait, turn the music up a little bit.
And Andy is going to measure, and those people will get the U.S. dollars.
All right. We have 1 minute left, ladies and gentlemen. 1 minute. You have to step away from your structure. You cannot hold on to it. 1 minute and counting. Oh, 1 minute, 45 seconds, ladies and gentlemen. And 30 seconds. You wanna now start to put the marshmallow on top and then step away from your structure. Put your marshmallow on top and step away in 20 seconds.
Six, five, four, three, two, one. Time
and
is up with the
marshmallow. Step away from your structure. Step away. Let go.
Marshmallow
let go.
On the top.
Let go.
Marshmallow
guys,
on the top.
Let me first of all, who has a full standing structure? Okay, I'm going to measure. I'm going to measure now. Hold on. Step away from your structure and step. Uh-oh. Okay, we have one. We got one structure here. Let me measure how tall you are. Okay, that is. I didn't mean you. I mean this. All right, this is about, okay. Oh, oh, I did. Okay, it was me. Okay, who else has a step? Oh, this is, never mind. That was a typical moment. All right, who else?
I'm gonna steal one.
Well, not bad. Let's see how, you guys are taller. You guys are? So far, the winner. We gotta let go, guys. Let go, and let go. And who else has a standing structure? We have about 25 inches right now. Who else has a standing structure? Please raise your hand. No, that doesn't even qualify. Sorry, guys. Who else? Well, let go. And let go. No good. Okay, who else? That's a good structure, but there's no marshmallow on top. Okay, standing, I said. Okay, and. Nah. All right, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, give yourself a hand. Please be seated. I'm going to reveal the exercise. Please be seated. You know, I told John I'd buy him beers. Let go. Let go. Let go. All right. Please be seated, ladies and gentlemen. We're wrapping it up. Now. Okay. Now you can eat the marshmallow. Now, besides being a fun exercise, ladies and gentlemen, 3 more seconds on your attention, because what we just did reveals actually very deep lessons. Lessons of collaboration, lessons of connecting, and well, who was the winner? 50,000, Greg, given the...
Is this table a winner?
50,000.
50,000 US dollars, a single bill.
$50,000.
Do you feel the heat? Do you feel the heat?
So, as I did this exercise around the country, and feel free to do this not only with your employees, but also with your families. It is a great exercise, and please allow me to explain what we just did. As I'm doing these exercises around the country, around the world, you know, there are certain people and certain groups of people who achieve certain measurings. And I'll give you an example. The average of people's accomplishments is about 20 inches. Average, right? Now, business students achieve about half of that. Graduates of recent business schools achieve about 10 inches. And there's a group of people who does better than all the rest. And these are recent graduates of people from a kindergarten. And I'll tell you why. Children think different than we think. You see, we are trained, as you are sitting here in this room, you are trained to find a single perfect solution for your problem. That's how we are trained. And therefore, here's what people do. When I watch people do this exercise, when 4 people come together, and even you orient yourself as a group, then you maybe sketch it on paper how you want to do your design, and then you start building. And you start building ever so tall structures, and at last you put that marshmallow on top, and you step away and you say, ta-da! But in reality, ta-ta-ta turns into an uh-oh. And that's what you just found here. Because we are trained to find that one single solution. Children, however, think differently. Children build prototypes. I did this exercise with my daughter, who is 8 years old, and I pretended on the dinner table that I didn't know what we were doing. So I'm like anybody else. I start building marshmallow and kaput. My daughter started with a marshmallow, and she still built backwards. And as she built backwards, she makes it stand, it falls, and she just learned what doesn't work. And she was able to recap, she was able to understand what kind of system works and what doesn't. That's why she built the highest structure of all, because she builds prototypes and she is not afraid to fail. We are so afraid of failure that we forget to let go and build new things. Now, lawyers doing about 25 inches, you know. Here's the interesting part. I've done this with general managers and CEOs, and they do about 26, 27 inches. They're pretty good, but here's the interesting part. If you put an administrative assistant on the team, they get significantly better. It's because our assistants, they have strategies how to solve problems. Where us, as leaders, we're often designed to think that we have to find that one single solution to fix it. Now, who does the very best? Engineers and architects, thankfully. Because they understand the geometric gravities of patterns of triangles to support each other. What we've just done, ladies and gentlemen, was much more than just building a spaghetti marshmallow tower. It is to show us that every project we have, every challenge we have, has a marshmallow. And if we don't learn to build prototypes, if we don't learn to understand that failure is not a defeat, failure is a learning experience, where failure drives us forward, and to me, at last, failure is the breakfast for champions. I'm out of time. My name is Andy. Thank you very much. Appreciate your day. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Andy.
Appreciate that.